This morning we are going to pick up again where we left off in Luke's Gospel last time. I'm going to review what it is we've looked at already, so I'm not going to say much more about that. But last week I did say that a couple of verses in this last paragraph are sort of like a hinge, because they're swinging us from what Jesus has said regarding John to the response toward John and, of course, toward Jesus, because John had been sent out ahead of him to announce that Jesus was coming. I think, obviously, we understand from what we've already seen that it's important that we do embrace what John had to say, that we embrace what Jesus has to say, that we follow true wisdom and not the world's wisdom. Otherwise, we know the consequences already. So let me read, beginning in verse 29 through verse 35. Now, one thing let me just mention as I say this, because in your Bibles, there's a debate as to whether these first two verses, 29 and 30, are actually a parenthetical insertion by Luke, simply describing the people's reaction to John, or whether Jesus is continuing to talk. And I think that's really what's going on here. Jesus is describing for us the response of those who heard John. So let's just look at it from that perspective. So Jesus says, when all the people and the tax collectors heard this, or heard John, they acknowledge God's justice, having been baptized with the baptism of John. But the Pharisees and the lawyers rejected God's purpose for themselves, not having been baptized by John. To what then shall I compare the men of this generation, and what are they like? They are like children who sit in the marketplace and call to one another, and they said, we played the flute for you, and you did not dance. We sang a dirge, and you did not weep. For John the Baptist has come eating no bread and drinking no wine, and you say, he has a demon. The Son of God has come eating and drinking, and you say, behold, a gluttonous man and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Yet wisdom is vindicated by all her children. Well, may the Lord bless these few verses to our edification this morning. Now, again, last week we saw from the messengers that John sent and Jesus' response that even strong believers, somebody like John the Baptist, sometimes struggle in their faith. Now, when John was ministering, he had no doubt that Jesus was the Messiah, and he boldly proclaimed that he was. It wasn't until he had to spend several months in a Roman dungeon. Things were hard. Things weren't turning out the way that John thought they should. But our Lord, rather than criticizing John, sent his messengers back with a message, with some evidence to strengthen his faith, so that he might know that his life and his suffering wasn't for nothing. Jesus cares for his own. That was one of the points we saw last week. Jesus cares for us. And Jesus also is going to give to us what it is that we need to strengthen us in our faith when it grows weak. Let me just mention, he has given to us several things. He's already given to us his Holy Spirit to convince us. To convince us, first of all, that his word is true. Remember when Jesus sent the messengers back, he said, look at what I'm doing. And go tell John what I'm doing, because John will recognize immediately that what I'm doing is exactly what the prophets said Messiah would do. In other words, you know, my ministry, my life is something that is a part of your history. It is a part of God's truth, and this will encourage him. I think one of the most powerful ways that the Word of God shows itself to be God's Word is through fulfilled prophecy. Now, not the vague and general kind of prophecy that we get from self-proclaimed prophets like Nostradamus. Maybe you've seen something of what he had to say in the past, and he sort of does this poetic kind of prophecy that can fit many different circumstances, and when those things come to pass, they say, look, Nostradamus could tell the future. Well, that's not the kind of prophecy we see here. We see specific and exact prophecy that can only come from the one who actually knows what the future is, And that's one of the ways we know that the Bible is the Word of God. But it's also God's Spirit who gives to us the full certainty and conviction that it is His Word. And by giving us that conviction, He also shows us that we are going the right direction and that we were right to trust in Jesus, that we were right to trust in Him for our salvation and to live in the way that He calls us to live. The Spirit also convinces us that we are the children of God because He gives us the confidence to call God our Father with the kind of certainty that shows or proves to us that we really are. You know, I think that that passage, the Spirit Himself bearing witness with our spirit that we are the children of God, is often misunderstood because what does the Spirit of God point to? Well, He points to the fruits of His work in our lives, the choices that we're making that are godly to show us that we really do belong to Jesus because we are becoming more and more like Jesus. But the reason I brought this up to this extent is this. The Spirit also points us from time to time to what God reveals about Himself in the creation to revive and restore our faith. You know, it's the Spirit of God who has given us all these things and makes them powerful to comfort us, to convince us, and to strengthen us. The Bible tells us that general revelation leaves everyone in the world without excuse. Everyone knows that God exists, and we're going to see some of that evidence as we look at the series in the evening. But that evidence can also strengthen our faith. You know, one of the things that I have to just mention by way of personal testimony, that when I've been so inundated with science in the past that I was tempted to doubt some of the things the Word of God says, I just turn back to what God reveals in the creation, and it eliminates all doubt. There is no way the world could be as it is, that it could even exist if God did not exist, and we need to be fully convinced that that is the case. As a matter of fact, I would go so far as to say all the evidence points in the opposite direction from evolution. There is no evidence for evolution, and I think if you had a chance to look at the evidence, you would agree with me. Now, we also saw that after the messengers left, that Jesus honored John by defending him from his critics. His critics who were saying that John was unstable. He was like a reed blowing in the wind. That he was a delicate man, like the rich in their palaces. And again, the idea that he's a man who is an effeminate kind of man, not a man's kind of man. They were basically criticizing him for that, which of course was just the opposite of what he was really like. That he was a lunatic because he lived in the wilderness and he didn't live in the civilized world. What is this crazy man doing out there? But they said these things because they hated John. Jesus defended him. By the way, I should mention, do we hear any of this kind of hate language going on today against Christians, against those who hold to a more conservative view, who hold to the Bible? Why does that happen? It's because the world hates the light. Jesus says the light comes in the world. This is the judgment. Light has come into the world, but the world loved darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil, and they would not come to the light because they did not want their evil deeds to be reproved. Jesus defends John, who was this bright light shining in the darkness in the wilderness, that he was a prophet. No, he was more than a prophet, because he was sent out to announce the coming of the Messiah. Among all who have ever been born into the world, he says, there was no one greater than John. And so that we would not think the greatness in God's kingdom was essentially only for the elite, Jesus also went on to say that we could be greater than John. Okay, but there's a big if here. If we will humble ourselves and serve him and honor him more than John did. It is the least in the kingdom, the greatest servant of all, who will be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Well, this morning we now see Jesus say two more things. First of all, in those first two verses that I sort of singled out, two different responses to John's ministry. And then secondly, Jesus' commentary on which of the two were the wisest. Well, first of all, we see two different responses to John's ministry. And again, I just want to point out that these verses 29 and 30 are more likely something Jesus said than a parenthetical comment by Luke. Now, he's telling us that as John went out to announce his coming, there were two different responses. The first was that of the Jewish people, not all of them, but a good amount of them, and some of the tax collectors. Now, many had come out to listen to John, and many of them had received his baptism, including tax collectors. And I think Jesus here is singling out tax collectors because they, above all the Jewish people, were hated by the Jews, and they were hated because they betrayed their own people. They were helping the Romans oppress the Jews by collecting taxes and often collecting more than they should so they could line their own pockets. Now, one thing that was interesting that occurred to me is if tax collectors were going out to listen to Jesus, maybe Matthew was among them. Remember who Matthew was? He was a tax collector, right? If he was, it might explain why he was so quick to follow Jesus when Jesus walks up to Matthew when he's in the tax office and he calls him. He immediately left everything and went to follow Jesus. It could be that he also had listened to John and had been baptized by John. But these Jewish people, these tax collectors, they believed John was a prophet, that he was God's messenger. They believed his message, that the Messiah was coming. Remember, his ministry was to get them ready for his coming. They believed what John said about them, that they were guilty, that God was just in condemning them. But they also believed his message, that Messiah would save them. You know, it's possible that these Jewish people and some of these tax collectors had the expectation that Jesus was coming to save them from Roman oppression. That was the general Jewish view, and that's why Jesus, a crucified Messiah, was a stumbling block to the Jews. That's why John may have been struggling in prison, because Jesus had not led the Jews to victory over the Romans, and he was still in a Roman prison by this Roman official. Is Jesus really the Messiah, or should we look for someone else? And that may be why it seemed like so many of the Jews were following Jesus at one moment, and then when he's put before them by Pilate, they cry out for his crucifixion. It's possible they had this expectation, but at least under the preaching of John at this time, they were responding in the right way. They listened to John. They repented of their sins, which means they turned away from the wrong things they were doing, not according to their standards, but according to God's standard. And they began doing the right thing according to God's standard, not according to their standard. They were baptized to show that they were truly repentant. And then they set their hearts to wait for the Messiah who was coming right behind John. John came 6 months ahead of Jesus. Jesus then, of course, came after the people were ready. They were made ready through the preaching of the law to bring God's people to repentance so they'd be ready to receive the Messiah. Well, they responded properly to John's ministry. But second, Jesus tells us how the Pharisees and the lawyers responded. They rejected John's message. They rejected his baptism. And in so doing, they rejected God's purpose for them. Now, the Pharisees, as you know, were the religious leaders of Israel, and they're also very pompous, self-pious kinds of individuals for the most part. They thought they were already just before God. They thought they were already acceptable. They had kept his commandments. Remember Paul, what he said about himself in his own testimony, that he had kept the commandments of God. But we need to understand that was only their reinterpretation of the commandments. It wasn't truly keeping the commandments the way that Jesus expounds them in the Sermon on the Mount. They thought they were the heirs of the kingdom, that they were going to inherit the kingdom simply by virtue of the fact that they were related to Abraham. They didn't need John. They didn't need his baptism. Now, the lawyers, on the other hand, these were the scribes, these were the writers, these were the copyists, the ones who gave their full time to making copies of the scriptures, who had spent so much time in the Word of God that they had become the experts in the Word. That's why they were the lawyers. Now, sadly, they thought that was enough, just knowing what God's Word actually says. Now, how many times do we make the same mistake? How many times do we make the Christian life to be nothing more than simply a quest to learn as much about the Bible as we possibly can, but do nothing else? We just spend all our time trying to learn what it says. Now, we do need to learn what it says. I'm not saying we shouldn't. but we also need to do what it says. And that's something neither the Pharisees nor the scribes were actually doing. James tells us in James 1:22, we need to prove ourselves to be doers of the word and not merely hearers who delude themselves. James is known as the great champion of the law of God, but from a gospel perspective, we don't throw the law out because we're saved by God's grace. God's grace gives us the power to obey him. He gives us the power to free us from the power of sin by putting love in our hearts for what is good so that we will serve him willingly. That's the blessing of the new covenant. God says, I will put my laws into their minds and I will write them upon their hearts and I will be their God and they shall be my people. This group rejected John's message and so they rejected his baptism of repentance because they believed they did not need to repent. Well, I think we know the obvious answer to this question, but Jesus goes on to tell us, of course, which was the right group, which one made the right choice, who was truly wise. He begins by drawing a comparison between the second group, what the Pharisees and the scribes are doing, and a group of children playing in the marketplace. Now, the image of children is used in Scripture in both a positive and a negative way. Jesus said on one occasion in Matthew 18, verse 3, truly I say to you, unless you are converted and become like children, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. Now that's a very positive use of the word child. What did Jesus mean by that? Well, he meant that unless we humble ourselves like a child and receive him or trust him and trust his word with a simple childlike faith, one that essentially accepts what parents tell them because the child trusts his or her parents, we will not enter into the kingdom of heaven. Jesus is telling us that we need to have that kind of faith, the faith of a child. Well, here, he's using children in a more negative way because children have other attributes as well, right? Sometimes they can be hard to please. He says in verses 31 and 32, to what then shall I compare the men of this generation? And what are they like? They are like children who sit in the marketplace and call to one another, and they say, we played the flute for you, and you did not dance. We sang a dirge, and you did not weep. Now, what Jesus was talking about here was the normal practice of Jewish children. They loved the marketplace. Okay, that's where people met. That's where people were interacting. That's where they're buying and selling. This is where things were taking place, as well as public events, celebrations, or things like mournings. You know, today it might be like children going with their parents to a department store. There's a certain age where children like to do that, and there's a certain age where they don't like to do that. But it would be the time which they do, because they see the department store like this huge playground where they can do all kinds of things they wouldn't ordinarily do. Well, one of the things Jewish children would do is, in their play, they would mimic the things that they saw. If it was a celebration, they might imitate the celebration. We played the flute for you. Or if there was a funeral, they might imitate what they saw them doing. We sang a dirge. Now, in this case, Jesus is talking about groups of children that are playing, but one group is trying to get the other to respond, but they were not playing along with them. We played the flute for you, but you didn't dance. We sang a dirge, but you didn't weep. In other words, nothing we're doing is pleasing to you. We can't make you happy. We can't do what it is you want to do so that you'll play along with us. Well, in the same way, the scribes and the Pharisees also could not be pleased. No matter what John did, no matter what Jesus did, nothing would please them. They accused John of being demon-possessed because he was living, as we saw last week or perhaps one of the previous weeks, a very ascetic kind of lifestyle. Verse 33, for John the Baptist has come eating no bread and drinking no wine. And what was his diet? Remember, he was eating grasshoppers, sweetening them with some wild honey, a very austere, kind of Spartan kind of life. Okay, you saw him doing this, and you say, this man has a demon. This guy's demon-possessed. Okay, yet they condemn Jesus for doing the exact opposite, doing what they would do, eating and drinking. Verse 34, the Son of Man has come eating and drinking, and you say, behold, a gluttonous man and a drunkard. And of course, because of the company he kept, they also called him a friend of tax collectors and sinners because he was eating and drinking with them. They had an attitude which I'll just paraphrase in this way, condemned if you do and condemned if you don't. Essentially, in their wisdom, they were hypocrites, okay, because of their hatred of Jesus. And so Jesus says in verse 35, yet wisdom is vindicated by all her children. What Jesus means by this is true wisdom. A godly understanding, the kind of wisdom we read about in Proverbs chapter 1, the kind we're to embrace, the kind that comes from the Scriptures. Again, the true understanding of Scripture and not just the way we want to interpret Scripture. And a godly understanding and application of this truth is vindicated, it's shown to be true wisdom by all of her children. That is, by what it produces, by the choices you make, by what you do with your life. The people and the tax collectors demonstrated they had true wisdom from God when they submitted to John's baptism. But the Pharisees and the scribes showed that they didn't when they not only rejected John's teaching, but also Jesus and his teaching as well. Well, I think the lesson is fairly plain, what our Lord wants us to learn from this. He wants us to be wise with true wisdom so that we will be safe, to follow the example of the people, the Jewish people, and the tax collectors who submitted to John, who listened to God's prophet, and who were baptized by him. We need to listen to what God says, and we need to do it. And let's not forget, this is not the honor system, okay? It's not the way it works in the Christian faith. It's kind of like, if we just do our best, if we do what we think is right, in the end, God is still going to accept us. He's still going to honor. That's going to be okay. No, you see, one day there's going to be a test. There's going to be an examination. One day, the choices that we've made, the fruit that we've borne, the children that our wisdom has basically given birth to, these things are going to be judged by Jesus on that last day. Now, if we listen to what Jesus says, and we trust him, and we follow him, then, Jesus says, we will truly be wise. And the things that we do will show that we do have the true wisdom. Because remember, on the last day, remember the sheep and goat judgment? Remember what Paul says about the judgment in Romans 2? Remember what Jesus says, well, through his Spirit in the book of Revelation, in Revelation chapter 20? Remember what Paul says in 2 Corinthians 5? Everything that is examined on the day of judgment is going to amount to what it is that we have actually done, how we have lived, the fruits that we have produced. Even what Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, when our works are going to be judged like this structure that we have built, and the fire is going to show us what it's really made of. Now, why are our works going to be examined rather than our profession? It's because our works show whether we truly know the Lord or we do not. We're not justified by our works. We're justified through faith in Jesus Christ. But our works, as James tells us, justifies the fact that we have true saving faith. Our true wisdom is vindicated by the children or what the wisdom actually produces. So if we listen to Jesus, if we trust Jesus, if we follow Jesus, on that day, we are going to show that we were truly wise because our works will justify us in the sense that it will prove that we had true saving faith. That's really the only way that any of us can see whether anybody else has faith. It's not by what they say, but it's by what they do. Is their conviction, is their faith producing fruit? You know, Jesus says a good tree will produce good fruit, a bad tree will produce bad fruit. You can know a tree by its fruits. Same thing is true of prophets, true prophets, false prophets. Same thing is true with regard to Christians. So If we've listened to Jesus, we've lived the life he's called us to live, we have let his wisdom override our wisdom, we've done everything according to his word, and again, we're going to fail in many ways, but we're going to do our best to get back up, repent, and go the right direction. If that's what we see, then that we'll be vindicated on that day and the Lord will receive us. But if, like the Pharisees and the scribes, we don't listen because we have a better way, because our way is right, because the way of the world is right, because we've chosen to accept their wisdom over God's wisdom, and we do not listen to him, if we reject him and his truth, then we'll show that what we had was not truly wisdom, but foolishness. And our works will do nothing but prove that we had a dead faith. And we will be rejected by God on that last day. The thing we need to remember is this is not a fairy tale. It's not a fable. This is real. And all of us are going to have to stand before him on that day. So Jesus' point is we need to live the kind of life that is the life of faith. We need to trust in him. Trust in him to save us. Not just believe that these things took place and that they're true. That's not faith. That's just believing the facts. But actually trusting Jesus to save us by his obedience, by his atoning death on the cross. Trusting and relying upon him alone to get us into heaven. And we know that we've done that when we see our lives being transformed into his image, when they exhibit true wisdom. So may the Lord help us to listen to what Jesus says, to listen to his wisdom, and may he give us the kind of life so filled with the Spirit of God that our lives actually vindicate not only our claim to faith, but also vindicate the gospel itself. Remember what Jesus said, "Let your light shine in such a way that men may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven." Well, let's bow for a moment of prayer, shall we? And let's ask the Lord to apply what we've heard to us as individuals.